also some other resources. Dear guests and audience, we have to accept some facts about the urmia. These are the realities. Global warming, drought, and lack of the rain are the realities that most of the researchers have accepted these facts. We all know that the urmia lake has been drying for two main reasons: natural factors and human factors. Among the natural factors, evaporation is the most important factor, but the human factors are numerous. Nowadays, the effects of bridge construction of dams, high water consumption of agricultural activities, unlicensed wells, besides the inefficient management and also short time benefits of some people are the main problems of the urmia lake. I believe that the public environmental stewardship in solving the urmia lake problem has priority over others. I heard from the researchers that are studying about the drying of urmia lake that people who are living around this lake and their life is directly related to it have many cultural problems. So I believe that legislation from the governments for solution on behalf of research will not work unless people believe and follow them. Recently, Dr. Fakhri Fahd, who is one of the researchers about the urmia lake, told me when cultivation of some plants gets banned, landowners rent their lands to other people who have not signed any commitments, and the renters cultivate any plants as they like, or they are keeping unlicensed wells by several concealment methods. So how legislation or research result can work before solving these problems? Regardless of these problems, each action can only be a waste of money and energy. I don't recognize that the scientific researchers completely are useless. I say that they should be all inclusive and, of course, applicable. Optimum management, taking responsibility by the people through increasing of knowledge among them may be able to help. Thank you.
Professor Reza, go ahead then, please.
Thank you very much. I have some questions about your presentation. I would like to compare something with newly research program and the implementation in Lake Umi. As you know, your presentation is focused about the climate change and some about consuming water in Lake Umi. But I have a question about climate change? Is there climate change affect the Finland's lakes? As you know, Finland is a country with more lakes. Approximately 165,000 lakes there in Finland. So that is maybe lucky for your country to dry some lakes for increasing fields for agriculture. But in our country, the problem is different. The two are essentially different. Finland's lakes have glacial origin, and while the lake of Urmia have tectonic origin and construction. But if the lake climate change will be influenced by the question why lake when in Turkey and seven lakes in Armenia have little impact of climate change. It seems that more research needs to be done about this problem. I believe that current approaches are likely to be temporary stability of the lake, proposed by some organizations, especially by government organization for down in the Lake Urmia, which listed in 90 projects without transferring water to Lake Urmia. I and some of my colleagues, certainly Professor Nurani, believe need to lake measures implemented with high reliability. High reliability measures need to Lake Urmia. Intubation water transfer and non-farm inventory. Transferring water from the Caspian Sea in the long term. This way, for interior basins, Iran is essential. I think this is essential for some basins in the interior of Iran. As you know, the polar ice caps melt will threaten the coast in the future. So, as to avoid climate change and save the large coastal cities, must be a global effort. Save inland lakes in arid and semi-arid countries. Save the world's coastal cities. No matter in which country the event is taking place, you should start investing in the field internationally. Like your presentation, your work is internationally, but we need to do locally. We should start a movement to cool the planet. We must follow this motto: we think globally and act locally. So, I would like you reply about my question. Are you believe we can transfer water from other sources to Lake Urmia?
So, you mentioned a lot of issues in your question.
Professor Kula, please just answer the questions when the final suggestions are made by you. I think it's better now Professor Norani just runs the speech and says his viewpoints, and after that we will hear from Dr. Torabi, and at the final you will just answer the questions. Thanks very much.
Good morning. Thank you all for coming to the event, Professor Anthropological Conference, very nice city, and of course very kind people. I hope we can continue our scientific collaboration with Ohio University. I have been asked here to mention and explain the undertaken plans and projects regarding the restoration of the Urmia Lake. I will just mention some briefly. The Central Committee of the Urmia Lake Rescue, located in the University of Sharif, has already provided 16 main aspects which should be focused to have a better picture about the lake. Each of these aspects include several projects. Some of the projects are now active and some are not, mostly due to budget deficit. If I mention these 60 aspects, I can say, one, assessing the impacts of freshwater recharge to the salty lake, something that Professor Rezaimovic said about, transform water from other basins, from other resources. Two, estimation of actual inflow and outflow of the lake. Three, development of water regulation by upstream dams. Effectiveness of the available irrigation system. Unconventional water resources. Solutions to reduce evaporation. Ecological restoration of the lake. Groundwater and surface water resources management and control. Health impacts of the lake dry-up process. Current steps of environmental alternative livelihood, agriculture water management, opportunities for water transfer to the lake, step-by-step restoration plan, lake and regional climate interactions, something that interaction of coastal aquifers and lake, southeast from Kong. Also here in University of Tabriz, we have a committee, we have a group, appointed by the Ministry of the Power, are responsible to monitor the projects that are undertaken about the rescue of the Urmia Lake. Every month we provide our results and report them to the Central Office of the Restoration in the Tehran. The six main projects that we are focusing on and that we create reports are one, restoration, dredging and reopening of the main rivers which discharge into the lake. Also, eliminating unauthorized water pumps which illegally get water from the rivers. Two, destroying and closing unlicensed wells digged illegally by farmers and automatic controlling the legal pumps. Three, overlook and monitoring the projects of renovation and modernization of traditional irrigation system and their replacement with modern systems such as drip and rainbird irrigation systems. Four, overlook and evaluation of the performance of greenhouse cultivation projects in the area. Five, monitoring the projects regarding transfer of Tabriz City wastewater treatment plant output to the lake. It is almost a steady discharge, steady water discharge, about 5 cubic meters per second. And finally, supervision of the projects for monitoring and controlling dust and salty soil. But actually, we are responsible to monitor the effectiveness of this project, but in this way, we are faced with two main problems and barricades. One is that the local organized in village and in small towns do not provide efficient cooperation, since everybody wants water and cannot ignore water to save for the lake. And the second problem is that in the Urmia Lake Basin in particular, and all around the country in general, we see human farming. It means that in each village there are many farmers who have ownership of small-scale farms and they cultivate independently and according to their own favorites This really creates problems to have an integrated water management plan for the basin. Of course, I have so many other materials, but I ignore them. Thank you very much again.
Thanks very much, Professor Nourani, for your remarkable points. Now it's time for Dr. Tarabi.
Okay.
Tarabi is speaking 5 minutes, please.
Yes, sure. And thank you very much. First, I would like to say something about Finland as our friend asked some question about Finland lakes. It's saying in Finland we have totally different situation in Iran. In Iran, we have more evaporation, less rainfall, but in Finland, we have more rainfall, less evaporation, or almost we have 2 times rainfall than evaporation. So, in Finland, we have an open lake. Here, we have closed lake. The lake in Iran plays at the end of watershed, but in Finland, we have the lake along the river. Each river has a source for the next river. Each lake has a source for the next river. But in Iran, lakes are sink for water, like here. In Finland, we have an outflow from each lake, but in Iran, I mean flow, discharge. But in Iran, we have only evaporation and seepage from the lake. This is the big difference between two countries. And in terms of environmental, as Nassim told, we have only problem with quality of water, not quantity, as you told. So, the problem is totally different from Finland and here. But anyway, about something that you mentioned, or something about Urmia Lake, I think main important thing is the price of flow, price of water here is very cheap, and the people don't pay any money, don't care about water, how they use it. Then another thing, environmental flow provided by water authorities in Iran. Then nobody pay any money for environmental flow to the organization, so they are not motivated to release environmental flow because there is no money from that. For example, Azerbaijan Water Authority don't receive any money if they release some water for environment, so they are not motivated to release water. Another issue in Urmia, I think we don't have perfect data in all the point about rainfall and inflow. If we want to make decision, first of all, we must have good monitoring and good data to do something. For example, I saw, for example, in the Kashtiban station, we have several data from the past, and for many years we don't have data. Again, recently they have some data, so we couldn't decision or make any models to make decision for Kashtiban catchment or that river. It is the other issue. And another thing, the time response that Björn mentioned in the presentation, when we start regulation of the lake, we must be calm. It takes long time. You know, for Urmia, it happened for 3 or 40 years, this catastrophe. But I think it takes 100 years to back to normal situation. We must wait. It is possible, but step by step. And because we couldn't ask a farmer to change quickly, we must step by step change the crop and behavior of farmer to make a new condition for the Urmia area. Another thing that professor asked about interbasin transfer water, I think it's problematic. When we transfer from water from, for example, Aras to Urmia, what's happened for Caspian Sea? Because the Caspian Sea has good ecosystem in the mouth of Aras River. Okay, we change the salinity of water for Caspian Sea, then it is problematic for Caspian Sea. Or we are not sure. We use this water for Urmia Lake. Maybe again this water is for agriculture. Then we have again new problem for Caspian Sea. Maybe transfer. Then another issue that transfer some water from Zab to Urmia Lake. Okay, now already we have problem in Arvandu with the amount of water and dust in aquas. Okay, if we will use some water here for Urmia Lake, again, we are not sure this water goes to Urmia Lake. Maybe they use it for agriculture again, but we increase the problem in Arvandu and increase the dust in aquas. So we must think, it is a very complicated problem, and it is not just one solution. We must sit together, socialists, economists, hydrologists, ecologists, together and make solution. It is not my job, your job, it is our job. Solve the problem. Thank you.
Thanks very much. As a panel member, to introduce myself because I just waited to finish the introduction, and then just as a panel member, I myself, I am Ali Mohammed Khorshidus, a professor in environmental studies. I thank you everybody for joining us and participating in this panel, especially those respectful academic members from the different faculties, Dr. Kuestani and also Dr. Nazemi and also Dr. Hasanzade, professor, all of them are professors. And also I would like to apologize to Professor Klaw and his colleagues for just the emptiness of the amphitheater. You're very close to the Nowruz celebration and also the holidays, and that's the reason why our amphitheater is not full of the students and all other colleagues. And if it was another time, I'm sure that the amphitheater was full of the attendance. So, as I am a professor in environmental studies and also I am a research dean of the faculty, I would like to just take a couple of minutes of your time about Urmia Lake, and then Professor Klaw will explain his views and also will answer the questions, and the panel will continue. Actually, I think I found out from the speech of Professor Klaw and the other colleagues that we don't have the main problem of climate change in Urmia Lake, as Professor Klaw himself just pinpointed it. His findings and also his colleagues' findings are showing that we don't have a big problem of climate change. We don't see a big problem of climate change in Urmia Lake. We had a panel 2 or 3 months ago in this faculty concerning the Urmia Lake restoration and also management and also impacts of Urmia Lake dryness and shrinkage. And we had some very, very important and special guests from England and other countries. And we just discussed the problem and the issue in there, and talking about the climate change. Yes, we know that we have the climate change all over the world. And also Professor Klaw talked about the NAO or NAO, and also probably ENSO, El Nino and other oscillation and other climatic factors that can affect Iran and other countries. But we have, as Professor Klaw pointed, we have the problem of mismanagement, land use changes, and the other main important problems and also subject and issues that Professor Jahanbash and other colleagues in here just explained. So I am very happy that Professor Klaw suggested something that is in line with my own findings. Thanks very much. And now, Professor Klaw, it's up to you to answer the question and also continue the panel.
Okay, thank you. So, yes, I think, first of all, I would like to say that I read the first panel discussion results from that. And I think I agree with a lot of the points that were raised here before. So I think it seems like there's a lot of information, a lot of ideas of what to do. Like I said, in my mind, I think it's quite clear that the irrigation agriculture is the main reason. Obviously, that is increasing a lot the water consumption. And obviously, if you know that's the basics of water balance, you know that will lead to a decrease in water level of the lake. But we also see that, I think a lot of this also seems to be happening relatively recently during the last development of the basin. Probably also during that time there were signs of lake level decline. But nevertheless, there was development of the basin. I think that obviously the key issues here is if you want to do something with the land use, the difficulty, of course, it will influence the farmer's livelihood. And you have a lot of issues there, obviously. You have some farmers have benefited from the irrigation. Some people have made a good profit from this irrigation development. Whereas other farmers have suffered a lot. So it's an equity issue as well. I think the
attach it from, I think, a very different high, both high level and low level strategies. So somehow I think that what is needed is strategies both at the maybe national scale, because if you increase agricultural areas, of course a national strategy probably is to increase food security, which is a very important topic for political people. But on the other hand, they must know, the politicians must know the consequence of that. Food security, if we increase food security, some farmers will benefit, some will lose, some lakes will disappear. And some of these changes are too costly for the society to bear, too risky. So I think the political strategies should be implemented, and there should be, I think, setting a goal for the future. Perhaps a goal which is not pessimistic, but rather optimistic. That is, at least in Europe, the European approach, we have a quite optimistic viewpoint for the future. Of course, some of the future we cannot achieve, but at least if we have this overall positive goal, this will guide everyone in society, from the top level to the low level, onto the farmer and the people and throughout the society. So I think that this strategic vision is important. Then, of course, if you look at food security, it's of course a very sensitive issue, but I think there the decision must be made by politicians. But of course, Iran is not a poor country; it's a lot of oil and resources, so probably you have some funds to buy food from elsewhere, or at least to provide the crops that don't consume much water, and improve the technologies in irrigation. But I think if you improve the technologies in irrigation, the unfortunate risk there is that if the farmers use less water to irrigate the crop, they might expand the agricultural areas. So the total consumption will not go down. This is a risk. So I think if you improve the technologies of irrigation and education of farmers, you must also control this expansion of agricultural areas. And perhaps focus on cultivation of the most fertile soils, and not, as I saw yesterday, a lot of soils that are fertile, very good, but not cultivated, whereas we saw some soils that didn't look very good from a soil fertility point of view, and I wonder why they were cultivated. So I think the overall regional planning is something that is needed here, and also strategies from the top level, from national level, and going down to the farmers, but also a bottom-up strategy. What can be done in this region? What can be done by the farmers, by the consumers, by agriculture? And in Europe, at least there is this top-down approach to be used in management of complex problems. I don't think it's so useful to blame anyone for the decrease. Normally, blaming doesn't really solve any problems. It's better to focus on the future, to think of